I'm Tammy Kolda, an applied mathematician, and this is Unlocking LaTeX Graphics. On this YouTube channel, I'm providing a detailed how-to guide on using TixEE and PGF plots. These videos are based on my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, as well as some bonus materials. PGF plots is a tool that enables you to create amazing figures right inside your LaTeX documents. Today, I'm going to provide an introduction so that you can get started with PGF plots. I'm going to focus primarily on getting the plot set up. This means creating an axis, adding a plot to it, resizing it, which is actually kind of tricky, adding a title and a label axes, which is also kind of tricky, adding a legend and changing the fonts. I'll close with recommendations on some default settings, which will make using PGF plots a lot easier going forward. You can absolutely use PGF plots without knowing TixEE. However, knowing TixEE makes everything much easier with PGF plots, and I'll put pointers to some of the relevant TixEE videos as we go. I set things up in advance for us at overleaf.com. So here's our basic document. The package PGF plots is essential. Notice I don't have to use package TixEE anymore because TixEE is included automatically with PGF plots. The parskip and full page packages are just to make things look nice, and the hyperref package is so that I can link back to the YouTube channel and the author name. Before we get going with any plots, the first thing I'm going to do is show you the data file, which is where we're going to get our data for our plots. So this file is called data.txt, and I've already uploaded it to Overleaf. This is formatted as a simple table. So you can have as many lines at the top as you want, preceded by pound signs. These mean these are comment lines, and so they are ignored. The first non-comment row is assumed to be the header row. You don't absolutely need one, and we'll talk about that perhaps in a future episode if you're interested. Rows are by default separated by new lines. Columns are by default separated by spaces. Other separators for rows and columns are possible, and we'll talk about that in a future episode. If you have anything that needs a space in it, like a column header, you should enclose that in curly braces. Now that we've seen our data, let's get back to our LaTeX document and get plotting. I am aware that there's a warning here that's caused by PGF plots, and we'll come back to how to fix that at the end of the episode. To create a plot, we create first a TixEE picture environment. That's always our drawing canvas. And then we put an axis environment inside of that. This is what is added by PGF plots. If we compile this, we see the default settings for the axis. We get a warning because we haven't actually plotted everything, but it gives you some idea of what the defaults are. It goes from 0 to 1. It has this default size. Now let's add some data from data.txt. So to do that, we use the add plot command. Inside the square braces, I give the style of the plot. So I'm going to say blue and mark equals star says to put circles at each data point. We focus on table data, and we're going to read from the file data.txt, which we put inside curly braces. And then we end every line with a semicolon. When I compile this, I want you to observe that the limits of the axes change automatically. That's one of the great benefits of using PGF plots. You can make it more specific, and we'll cover that in a future episode. By default, the first column of data.txt is our x-coordinates, and the second column is our y-coordinates. We can, of course, change that by adding options to table. So here I'll put y equals b. That will say to use the b column rather than using the a column as our y coordinates. When we recompile that, I want you to notice is not only that does the plot change, but so do the axis limits. We're not going to spend a lot of time on add plot or table today. We're going to focus mainly on options to the axes so you know how to do things like resize, add a title, axis labels, and a legend. We'll come back to many other features in future episodes. Now that we've done our first plot, you may want to think about how you might change it. The first thing we'll change is the size of the plot. It can be a little bit tricky. Let me start off with a repeat of our previous plot. The only thing I've done here is change the styles just so you can see some other examples. It's now olive and thick, and I've changed the mark to be an open circle. To change the size, you just add the width and height as an axis option. So I'm going to try and make it 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters. Let's see what happens when I compile this. It turns out it did not come out to be 3 centimeters by 3 centimeters. This is a peculiarity of PGF plots. When I first saw this, I thought I had lost my mind. I'm not going to go through the details of how it actually works. I'm just going to tell you how to fix it. But before I do that, this is a 3 centimeter by 3 centimeter box in red. And I'll link in the show notes to the TixEE that I used to draw that. But you could see that it's not the right size. This is not just some strange phenomena of the video. So we can fix this with a magic option that's called scale only axis. This should be a default option for PGF plots. And at the end of the video, I'll show you how to make it the default. When we compile with this option, you can see indeed that now it knows to interpret the width and height as the width and height of the axes themselves. The next thing we'll talk about is adding a title and axis labels. Let's start again with our last pictures. I'll just modify the style a bit. Again, I've also changed the size to be 4 centimeters by 3 centimeters. Here I said the style should be dashed and then mark equals square, and then I added an asterisk. The asterisk always means fill the marker in. I didn't specify a color, and the default color will just be black. The title and axis labels are specified as axis options as well. So let's go ahead and add that here. I will note that there is no space between X and label. Whether or not there's a space in the option is a little bit random in PGF plots, so you just kind of have to remember whether or not there's a space. When you compile this, we see that we get the title is my plot and the X and Y axes are labeled. One thing that's odd is that this Y axis label is very far away from the Y axis. Again, this is an unfortunate default of PGF plots. One way that you can fix this is by adding X label near ticks and Y label near ticks to the axis options. This will cause these labels to go right up against where the ticks are. I recompile and you can see that it's now fixed. To see this explicitly, I'm going to use some advanced TickZ knowledge and I'm going to frame all the nodes in red. It turns out that the title and the labels and even the tick labels are all little nodes. And so I'm drawing the outlines of all of those. When I add these special option, X label near ticks and Y labels near ticks, what it does is it puts the top of the X at the bottom of the X tick labels and the bottom of the Y at the edge of the Y tick labels. This is a nice debugging tool if you run into problems with the placements of your nodes. The next thing we'll talk about is adding a legend. Let's start off with what we had before, except for now I'm going to plot 2 lines. Each add plot command uses a different column from the data.txt file. The result of compilation is shown over here. Now it would be useful to have a legend because we have these 2 different lines. So we can add a legend using the axis option legend entries. Let me paste this here. The entry should be in the same order as the add plots. So we did first data set A and then data set B. The legend position default is the northeast corner. This legend is somewhat overlapping our plots, so I think we should move it. There's 5 options that are preset. We have northeast, northwest, southwest, and southeast. None of those are going to work, but we can also do outer northeast. So let's go ahead and set that as our legend pause. When we compile that, we see that our legend has indeed moved to the outside. Another essential you'll probably need is the ability to change the fonts in your graphics. So let me repeat our prior picture, and I sized the right-hand side so that you can see both at the same time. To change the fonts, you just add some more options to the axis options. So here we have title style, label style, tick label style, and legend style. And then inside of those, I can specify the fonts, among other things. When I do that, I've changed the size of the title to be boldface and large. I've changed the label style to be normal size. Actually, that doesn't make any change at all. I've changed the tick label size to be footnote size, and I've changed the text in the legend to be size small. Technically, these commands are pending the underlying TickZ styles, and we'll get into the nuances of that perhaps in a future video. For me, I also observed that this title is really too far away from the underlying plot. You might be tempted to just adjust the style with a Y shift, and you could do that, but there's actually a special option that controls where that goes. It's every axis title shift. Even though it says every, it actually only affects the current axis. The default is 6-point, and I'm going to change it to 3-point. That moved it a little closer, and now I'm happy. I've recommended a few settings that you might want to repeat in every single PGF plot graphic, but you don't really want to have to type all these settings every single time. So you don't have to repeat these standard settings. There's something called PGF plot set. It's very much like TickZ set if you're familiar with that, and it affects all subsequent commands in its scope. If you want to affect your entire document, you just set it up at the top. So what I might do in this document, for example, is go all the way up to the top. And after I use package PGF plots, I can set my defaults. So I would recommend that you always include scale only axis, X label near ticks and Y label near ticks as defaults. And then you can add other things that you like as well. For example, I really want my default title shift to be 3 points rather than 6 points. You might also set default sizes and so on. Finally, if you want this little warning to go away, one thing you can do is add compat equals 1.17. This is basically telling PGF plots that it should use the defaults that go with version 1.17 and not the original defaults. This is a way that PGF plots make sure it's backwards compatible. And so the document you create today will compile the same way in 20 years from now because you've specified the compat. But if you don't specify anything, you get that warning. When I specify a compat, it makes that triangle go away. I should also note that when you use 1.17, these actually become the default, so you don't have to specify them. But because a lot of us don't actually specify the compat, I wanted to make sure you knew how to fix that. And so there's sort of two different ways, specifying a more recent version that makes those the defaults or telling PGF plots that those are your defaults. I hope you've enjoyed today's video. You should now be able to create some plots using PGF plots. We showed how the data files should look, how to create a very basic line plot, how to adjust the size of the axis, add axis labels and a legend, and change the fonts. There's a link to the Overleaf document we used today in the show notes. Please click like or subscribe if you want more videos like this. You can also buy my book, Unlocking LaTeX Graphics, at your favorite book retailer. Thanks for watching.